This tutorial is sponsored by environmenttextures.com, high-quality images for 3D artists and game developers. Hello there, beautiful people. In this video tutorial, or video tutorial series, depending on which way you choose to view it, I'm going to be showing you how to go about making this beautiful low-polygon barrel, and it's using a high-polygon to low-polygon workflow. So, what you will do is using a reference image, such as this one here, you're going to create a low polygon mesh like this from a high polygon mesh like this one. So you can see this one's got quite a lot of beveling going on. And you can see that the number of triangles in this is well over 6,000, which would be very wasteful for something like a barrel. So we're going to use normal matte baking to reduce that number down to, in this case, I've got 352. And it's got a massive amount of detail in it. We're also going to be looking at using a PBR shader. So in this case, we're going to be using the Stingray PBR. And you can see that without all that detail on, this is what our low polygon barrel looks like. So we're going to put a lot of work into this. We're going to create a really beautiful normal matte. So you can see this is just the same polygon count, but look how detailed it now looks. We're going to use a metallic map to tell it which parts of the shader should show as metal. We're also going to add a roughness map in so that the wood looks wooden and the metal looks shiny. Obviously, of course, the important one to make it look right, there'll be a color map on there as well, a diffuse map to finish that all off. If you want to take a look at the finished file itself, the actual Maya file where I've created the barrel, as well as the texture files that I've created in Photoshop, then you can access those by becoming a patron. If you look at the link below, you can go to Patreon, look at my page, and if you want to support me, then you'll get access to pretty much everything I do on this channel, as well as if you want to become a patron, you can ask me additional questions. I'm about to start doing a monthly session, maybe 1 to 2 hours, where my patrons will be able to join me in a Google Hangout. You know, we'll talk about modeling, I'll make some stuff, I'll show people, answer questions, whatever. So you could consider that if you want to be a part of all of that. But I think that's enough introduction-y stuff done. We should probably get stuck into making this barrel, shouldn't we? Okay, stick around. We'll move on to step one in a sec. Okay, so we're going to make a start on getting this barrel made. And as always, the first thing I want to do is set a new project for this. So we're going to click on File, we're going to go to Project Window, and I'm going to make a new project. I'm going to call it Barrel, because it's a barrel, it's a good name. And the location, just because I like to keep all my things to like somewhere I can see them, and then I tend to move them later. But I'm going to put it on my desktop for now. And then all of these folder names are going to be fine, so I'll click on Accept. Okay, with that done, what I now want to do is find the images I will need. And so I'm going to go out to environmenttextures.com, which is just here. Oh, that's lovely. Big, starey man looking at me. Okay, so this just so happens to be the sponsor for this video as well. So I'll give them a shout out. This is what I'm currently using to find pretty much all of my reference images and texture files as well. So what we need first of all is a picture of a barrel to work from. So the search function on here is pretty good. So if I search for a barrel, I'm hoping that's what I'll find. Ah, lovely. So I can see there are lots of metal oil drum looking barrels. But the kind of barrel I want is the first hit, which is this handsome looking barrel right here. Oh, oh, that's nice. Okay, so I think I'm going to use this to work from. I'm going to make a little change. I don't think I want that metal band on the top, but I think I do want these four, and the proportions look good. So I'm going to take this. So if I click on this, I'll have that one ready to go. Right, I'm also going to need some texture files for this. You can see I'm probably going to need a wooden one and a metallic one as well. So I think what I'll do next is I'll look in categories. And there's some really good wooden ones. So let's go to wood. Yep, and the sort of thing I'm looking for, I think in this instance, is going to be planks and probably bare. bare as in no paint or anything, not bare as in a bear made out of wood. That would be ridiculous. Okay, so let's see what we've got here. Something that looks nice and barrel-y. This is quite good. I think I want something that looks a bit more aged. I think I'm going to go with this one. So I'm going to try and make my barrel look a bit more gnarly than the one in the reference. I quite like this. So I'm going to take this image as well, I think. There it is. It's got some nice scratches and things on it, so I'm hoping that'll come through nicely in the normal map that we'll create. So I'm going to take that one. Right, I need some metal next. So let's find something metallic. Let's try plate metal. Galvanized metal doesn't look bad. Maybe that's the one I'll go for. Ooh, or scratches metal. Let's try scratches. I'd already kind of decided on the other two I was going for, but I hadn't decided on my metallic one. These look nice. I might go with one of these. They're good. Yeah, let's see what this one looks like at the top. This one. And the good thing about these textures is they're all really high resolution. Maybe I'm not a massive fan of that one. Let's try the next one. What's this one like? It's got bits on it. I don't like the bits. Let's keep searching. Okay, so we're not going to go scratches. Well, we might come back to scratches. But let's have a look at galvanized. Yeah, I like this one. So I'm going to go for metal plate 3. That should give me something to mess around with. Yeah, so we'll save that one as well. Okay, so I've got my three materials. So what I'm going to want to do is find my barrel project. I'll just stick that over there. And in my source images folder, which is where all your textures should live, I'm going to drop these. One, two, where's the other one? Three. So we've got wood, barrel, and that will be the galvanized metal. Let's rename these then. So we'll have metal, barrel, reference, and wooden planks. Okay, so that is the images found. So thank you very much, Environment Textures. Thank you for sponsoring this video, and thank you for providing me with some beautiful pictures. That's wicked. Right, we can kill that for now. And then the next thing we need to do is get back into Maya and set up the reference image. So I'm going to go into my front view, I believe. And I'm going to click on View. I'm going to go to Image Plane and Import Image. And because I've put my images in the right place, which is very good practice, I can see my barrel reference image. So I'll open that. There it is. And what I'm going to want to do is move that up so that it kind of sits roughly on the bottom. Now, there's obviously some perspective to this image that kind of needs to be addressed. But as long as it's in roughly the right place, I'll be able to work with that. Okay, so that about wraps up the first part, which is kind of preparing your scene, so making sure that you've got your reference image and your texture files ready. In the next step, we'll start building the high poly version of the barrel. I will see you there in the next step. Bye. Okay, so here we are in step two. It's going to be a little bit of a longer step than the last one. We've got a bit more to do. And now we're going to start making the high polygon version of the barrel. So we're going to start by building it out of planks. So our first plank is going to be a cube. And at this stage, it's just occurred to me that it's a good idea to move that back out of the way. So I'll do that. And then I'm going to start just shaping myself something that looks plank-like. So something like that. Yep, Right, I'm just going to try and get it to a height that I'm pretty happy with. And what I really want to do, just to make my life easier, especially if I was importing this into a game engine like Unreal, I want to try and line the bottom up with the grid, just so I know where that's going to be. I'm quite happy with that. But I actually want the plank to be on this side, and that's so that I can line up the bend later. So what I'm going to do is rotate it around so that it's not facing that direction. So let's get the rotate tool on. I'll begin moving that around, and then my channel box, I'll notice that I have been rotating it on Y, so I'll call that 90 degrees. Lovely. And then I'm going to hold my D key. In fact, I'm going to put my move tool on first. Hold my D key and then hold my V key, which will snap to vertex, and that will just drop my pivot to the bottom of the plank, which I want to do. And then I'm just going to move this out to the edge. Like that. And then what I need to do is bring that pivot back into the center. So now I'm going to hold D, and I'm going to also hold X on the keyboard. X will snap to grid points. And I'm just going to put that pivot bang in the center of the grid. So I'll try and show you that as best I can. You can see the pivot is now there. And what that does is, if I was to rotate this, now that I've moved the pivot point, it goes around the center. I'm going to use that to create the outline of the barrel. Okay, so now what we need to do is duplicate this first plank that we've got, so that it creates a full radius, a full roundy barrel-y thing. So the way I'm going to do that is by using duplicate special, and I'm going to create 15 copies. That'll give me 16 in total, which is a nice round number for this. And I'm going to instance them instead of creating straight duplicates, which means that if I change one, ideally the original, in fact let's rename that to plank so that I know which one the original is. So if I change the original, it will change all of the others, which means that I can continue to edit even though I've got copies. But you'll see what I mean. So if we go for edit, duplicate special. Right, here's my duplicate box. I'm just going to go to reset settings, so we've got a brand new duplicate special tool, so you're looking at the same as I'm looking at. So I want instance on there, and I'm going to rotate each copy 22.5 degrees on the y-axis. And if you do your maths, I think 22.5 is what happens if you take 360 and divide it by 16. And I want 15 copies. So if I now click on duplicate special, you will see that that creates that amazingness, which is what I wanted. So I can make changes to this, but what I can't do is just scale it. With instancing, for some reason, it doesn't like that. It won't be copied on the others. So what we'll do is we'll put it into vertex mode, select all the vertices, and using the scale tool, we'll just scale it out like that. And you'll see that's being matched by all of the others. I'm not going to push it out all the way yet. I'm just doing it to get it quite close. I don't need it to be 100%. We'll refine that later. But it's just to give us a much nicer looking circumference. Is that the right word? That's what I'm going with. So you can see that's still plank. So I know that that's my original. The others are named appropriately. Plank 1, plank 2, whatever. So I need to do a little bit more work on plank 1 to get this looking more barrel-like. So the first thing I'll do is I'll bevel this plank. So I'm going to open my modeling toolkit for this, which lives up here. And if I scroll down, there's my bevel operation. And I'm going to go 0.1 for the fraction. And I'm going to have 2 segments, I think. And that just gives a nice smoother edge on each of the planks, which is what I like. The next thing I want to do is get that bend, that bend there. So the way I'll do that is, first of all, I'm going to need some extra edge loops. So my current favorite way of adding edge loops is something I learned from Mike Hermes. If you haven't checked out his channel, MH Tutorials, I think it is. It's worth a look. It's very good. He starts all his videos with, "Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. which I like. He's got a cracking little accent, that guy. So we need to use this tool. So insert edge loop tool, click on your options box. You'll probably start on relative distance from edge. Go to multiple edge loops, and we want 5. So we'll type 5 in that box. Okay, and then to get 5 edge loops on the height, you have to click on one of the edges that's running up and down. So like that. And you'll see that it places edge loops 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and they're equidistant, equal distance from each other. And that's wonderful. And that sets us up to be able to bend this plank. So I'm now going to go back into object mode and select my original plank. Just go into the channel box to make sure that's what I've got. And now I'm going to apply a bend deformer. So that lives in this little menu here, deform. If you click on this and you look for nonlinear, the first option there is bend. And by default, it should be facing the right way. So we'll click on this and hope it works. So that's applied the bend deformer. We need to go into the attribute editor to find. In fact, we could probably do it from there, but I like it from the attribute editor. If we go to bend one, you can see there's a curvature slider. And that, whilst it looks amazing, is not what I'm looking for. Okay, so if you find that your bend is going in the wrong direction, this is not useful to us at all. The way to change it is if you go to your bend handle tab and have a look at your rotate, and I can see here I've got 90 on saved here. So I'm just going to put that back to 0, and that should sort it. You can see now that's bending outwards. So I've got a good idea of how that should look. So now I'm going to go back into my front view. I'm going to try and match up the curvature of the barrel. So let's bend this in a little bit. I think I might just go in slightly more than that. Yeah, I'm fairly happy with that. So that's a nice even bend. So you can see that the bend on this barrel is actually not consistent. But I want mine to be consistent. So I'm happy with that. So let's have a look. Yeah, that's looking a lot better. So we can now say that we've got a nice barrel-y shape. So next thing we need to do is do a little bit of tidying up on this plank to make sure that they all sort of mesh together nicely. Okay, so in order to do that, we need to go into our vertex mode. And I'm just going to select the vertex at the top, put my scale tool on, and just bring these in. I'm going to have to do this a few at a time, I think. You see, I'm quite happy with that one, but these ones aren't quite right, so I'm just going to correct this as well. Like that. And it should only really matter on these front ones that they line up, because we're only going to be able to see those. We're not going to be able to see the outside ones. So I just need to take care to get these lined up to where I like them. And I'm trying to get a bit of a gap. I don't want them to match up perfectly, because there's no point doing the planks if that happens. I want to be able to get a bit of detail on my normal map. So I don't want them to go quite through each other. So let's have a look at this. Ping that out. Yep. Okay, what does this one need to do? In or out? Now like that. And okay, and the position of the vertices do matter on this one, because this can be seen on the normal map. That wasn't a very good selection. There we go. And then just get this one right as well. Let's put this into object mode, see if I'm happy with it. So that's okay. Yeah, that's pretty nice. Have a look at the top. Yeah, so there's a little gap in between, but all in all, it comes together quite nicely, which I like. Okay, at this stage, I'm pretty much happy that I'm done with that bend modifier. So what I'll do is I'll select that one plank that's got it applied. I'll go to Edit, Delete by Type, History, and that will just make that bend permanent. That's now part of the mesh, and the deformer's gone now. so that's all nice and neat. Okay, so the next thing we'll do is create another set of planks for a lid. So that's just going to be another cube. So I'll just create one. I'll bring this up. And I just need to size this out. So it just needs to just intersect my geometry there. And I want a bit of width on it. Maybe slightly wider than the planks that make up the outside of the barrel. And I think just to stop things from looking too uniform, I'm going to offset it slightly as well, like that. And then if I go into vertex mode, I can see that I've created a little problem for myself. So I'll just correct that, push that back inside. And I'll have the same issue at the top. So get hold of that, push it back in. Oh, yes, mate. Okay. So now I'm just going to put this back into object mode. This needs a bevel on it so that we're getting a bit of extra detail. So let's go back into modeling toolkit, drop a bevel on that. I definitely want two segments, and let's try 0.2. Am I happy with that? Yeah, 0.1. Yes, okay. So now what I need to do is duplicate this a few times so that it works. So I want to get in nice and close on this just to make sure that they're meeting. That's nice. And I'm going to do Shift and D to get another one. Obviously, I need to correct those a little bit. Okay, I'm going to get these two and duplicate them and bring them this way. And then as long as I can get this meeting up nicely, I'll be happy. Yeah, about there. Okay, and now what I need to do is just sort the vertices out on these. So let's scale them in, make sure that they're not protruding at all, and get these verts as well. So they definitely need to come in. These two here need to go right in over here. Oh, didn't get them all. Try again, chain. There we go, bring these in. And then just scale them so that they are not sticking out. So I'm happy with that side. And then vertex. Get these bad boys, chuck them inside. Get these verts here. Get those inside as well. And these bad boys out here need to be moved in and scaled in. Champion. Okay. Let's just investigate. What are you doing? There we go. Right. Oh, that's handsome, isn't it? Look at that beautifulness. Okay. So now what I need to do, I've got that and I'm happy with it, but I need to duplicate it because there's no shape on the bottom. So let's just bring that down, and when nothing's sticking out, about there, that should be good. That suggests that I didn't position those verts very well. Object mode, okay. And am I happy with all these? These ones look all right. Yeah. Okay. So that is pretty much all the wooden high poly geometry done. The next thing we need to do is add the metallic band. Right, so the next shape we're going to need in order to do this is this one, polygon pipe, and I'm going to scale it up so I can see what I'm doing. Maybe that's a bit big. And I'm going to go into the inputs for this shape, poly pipe one, and the thickness needs to be brought down. The height obviously needs to be brought under control. And then what I'm going to do is just come into this view here and try and get this into a position that I'm happy with. So I think somewhere like that I might end up being happy with. And I'm just going to size that down. Let's move it up a little bit more. Okay, let's just go back out into this view and see if I'm happy with that. Yeah, I am actually. So, let's turn the grid off, it's getting in my way. So from this sort of view, I think that looks okay, but from the bottom, it really doesn't. So in order to sort that, I'm gonna get the faces on the bottom, and just, so I clicked once, then I held shift and double clicked on the one next to it, and that selected the whole edge loop for me. And then I'm gonna try and scale these in a bit, just to try and keep that consistent. So I'm happy with that one. What I'll do next is I'll duplicate this one and I'm going to move it up to the top. Now obviously that's not oriented the right way, so I want to flip this on the y-axis, and the way to do that is scale y needs to be inverted. So you can see it's set to 1.857. If I put a minus in there, that flips it around, it just turns it upside down. It's an amazing little trick. I loves it. Okay, so I'm going to pop that one about there. Do they look about even? Yeah, so I'm happy with those two. What I need to do next is select this one. And I'm going to duplicate it. Bring it down to be sort of in line with the next place it needs to be. And scale it out. And I'm going to change the height on it as well. So it looks like a similar height to the previous one. And let's see if I'm happy with that. I'm very happy with that. That's fantabulous. Okay, so I'll duplicate this one more time to bring down to where the last metal band will be. Okay, I'm going to invert the height on the Y scale. So at the moment it's minus 1.5. So I'm going to get rid of that minus. And that'll flip it around. And then that should be good. So what I'm going to do now, because it's getting a little bit difficult to see, I'm going to use this here, which is a wireframe unshaded, which will just help me to see where things are. Yep, that's looking okay. I'm just going to turn that off. Okay, so what I need to do now is bevel these just so that the edges aren't too hard. So let's get these outside edges. So that one. And that one. We'll bevel them, and I definitely want two segments again. I shouldn't need any more than that. And the fraction, let's do this by eye. I think 0.2 is nice. So I'll repeat that for the other ones. So there's this one. I need to get that edge and that edge. Bevel, two segments, 0.2. Next one, come on mate, get in edge mode. Right, that one, bevel them up good, 0.2 and two segments. And there's only one more left to do, this one. Let's bevel it. Ah, no, what am I doing? The edges, bevel the edges, Shane. Ooh. That one, yeah, bevel. 0.2 and two sections. Okay, let's put that back into object mode. Right. At this stage, we can call the high poly done. I'm happy with that. That's cracking. So, what I'll do now is select the whole thing. I'm then going to combine it into one mesh. Mesh combine. And I'm going to rename that to high underscore poly underscore barrel. Okay, so that's brilliant. That's finished. What we'll do in the next step will be we'll spend some time retopologizing. I think I'm saying that right. So we will create a new barrel from scratch, but it will be much lower polygon. We'll have no bevels on it. We'll have no kind of additional geometry. We're just going to try and match it as closely as we can to this high poly version, so that we can take the detail from this one using normal matte baking and put it onto the low polygon one, which should be good. So I look forward to seeing you in that next step. Okay, in this step, we need to make a low poly version of this barrel. Right, so what we need to do first of all is make sure that we're not going to accidentally interfere with this one anymore. We're going to add it to a layer and make that layer a reference so that we don't, you know, break anything. So let's have this selected. In your channel box at the bottom, you've got layers. Click on layers and we're going to create layer from selected. So it will put what we have selected into a new layer. And we'll double click on that to give it a name, which will be high poly, and save. And then with this, you can do things like turn the visibility on or off. And here, you can change it to reference. So now, once I deselect it, can't click on it no more because it's reference. So, you know, it's tough. If you ever forget that, though, you're like, oh, man, can't click on it. Why not? Oh, it's because it's in reference. You know, take the R out and it'll be fine. Okay. So now what we need to do is create a brand new shape. So we're going to go with a cylinder. Wicked. Now, importantly, we want to try and get the same number of subdivisions on the axis as we have planks of wood, which will make life a bit easier. So I'm going to change that to 16 because we've got 16 planks of wood. Right, let me just scale this up a bit so we can see what we're working with, and I'll just move it up. And what you should be able to see, if I zoom in, is that these aren't quite lined up. There's like an offset, so each one of these is kind of like halfway past the other, if that makes sense. And to fix that, we're just going to rotate it on the y-axis by 11.5 degrees. And they will now match up perfectly, which makes our job a little bit easier. Okay, so what we'll do next is try and match the height. So I'm going to get vertices, I think. So I'm going to get my top row of verts, and then I'm going to press and hold V on my keyboard, which will snap to vertex, and then I'm going to click to move up, and I want that to go as high as it will possibly go, like so. And then same for my bottom row. I'm going to hold V, I'm going to move that down like that. And that will just mean that the height is absolutely perfect, or it definitely should be. They should now match up, which is really good. The next thing we know is to get the curvature as we want it, we're probably going to need 5 subdivisions going along the height. So in order to do that, I need to be back in object mode. And I'm going to go to mesh tools, insert edge loop tool. And this is still set up from when we used it previously, so I can click on that. And the job is a good one. Okay, so now what we need to do is try and match up the radius of each one of these rows. And what I would recommend doing, because it's symmetrical on the y-axis top to bottom, I would work on a couple of rows at a time. So, I'm going to make sure I'm in edge mode. I'm going to click my top edge and my bottom edge. No, I'm just going to do it one row at a time because I'm going to have a problem otherwise. So, I'll just get my top edge. Right, let's get into this nice and close so that I can see what I'm doing. I might even go to show, nope, not that one, shading, wireframe unshaded. No, that's not what I'm looking for. X-ray, that's what I want. And it'll just make it a bit thicker, easy to see. So then I'm going to scale that in until it matches as close as I can get it to where that is. So you can see now, if I just zoom in on the corner here, see that pretty much matches up, which is what I'm going for. And I need to do that on each row. And I'm scaling from the center because I want this to scale uniformly. And stay, that'll just keep it as a circle, which is kind of important. And that one there. bring this one in to there. Next one. And I'm just matching up with the topology, with the mesh of the high poly version. So make sure everything is fan-dabby-dozy. Oh, that's nice. Okay, so if I put that back into object mode. And back into my perspective view. Right, so now, if I flick on and off the visibility of the high poly, like this, the shape pretty much stays there. It's quite happy with that. Which is what I'm looking for. That's good. That's real good. Okay. Right, next, we need to work on the top and the bottom. And this is going to be extruded, and then with some snapping, we're going to try and match things up. Hopefully. So, let's get these faces on top. So I just need to make sure I've got all these going. Nice. Okay, and then I'm going to hit Control and E on the keyboard, which is the keyboard shortcut for extrude, but you can also use the icon there, or there's an extrude in the modeling toolkit somewhere. So, you know, it's not like it's hard to find, but Control and E is my favoritest way of doing it. Okay, and then, unhelpfully, the pivot's over here. So if I tried to, like, scale it, oh, actually, it would be fine. But I'm not going to scale on that axis because it freaks me out. So I'm going to press R on my keyboard, and I'm going to scale from there. And so I'm just going to scale him, and then move it down. I want to try and match up the height with what I've currently got. So I'm going to get in nice and close on this. I can always come back and change this later, but I want to get it as close as I can straight away. And that actually looks pretty spot on. So you can see I'm almost tracing the high poly geometry. So that's my first extrusion. Then I'm going to hit Control and E to extrude again. This time I'll put my move tool on and move it straight down. And I'm just trying now to match, there we go, with where the planks are. And then I'm just going to push that out. And again, I'm matching to get the curvature, like so. So I can now put that back into object mode. I'm happy with that end. And again, if I just flick the visibility on and off, you can now see that there's very little difference. The only difference that is really popping out is the metal bands. Which is good, that's what I want to see. And I just need to repeat that process on the bottom. Okay, so now my low poly barrel is basically finished as well. That was nice, wasn't it? That was easy. I like it when things are easy. Oh, that was lovely. Okay, so let's get naming. This one's going to be called low underscore poly underscore barrel. Lovely. And I'm going to add this one to its very own layer. Layer, create layer from selected. And I shall call this layer low poly. L-R-W-P-R-L-Y. And save. Okay, wicked. That's now pretty much set up to do your texture baking with. There is only one other thing that I think it's useful to do to get a cleaner normal matte bake, or what something I found from my own experience anyway, is to soften the edge of your low polygon mesh. So in order to do that, you just click on mesh display, and you will see soften edge. And if I just hide the high poly, you'll see that it actually looks kind of weird. It looks a bit confused, but the harder edges should come back when we do the normal matte baking, hopefully. Okay, so in the next step, we will be texture baking. We're going to bake a normal map from the high polygeometry to the low polygeometry, which should look really good. So I'll see you in that step. Okay, so what we need to do now that the low poly is complete is UV map it. Oh, no one likes UV mapping, but I think if we work together, we can get through it. So we're going to map different parts of this at a time. So let's just get into face mode and we'll select all these faces that go around like that. How have I selected the bottom? I didn't want to do that. Okay, let's just get the selection in this view. Okay, so I just want those faces around the side first of all. And then we're going to go to, I'll open my UV editor so I can see what I'm working with. Okay, and can I just make that a little bit more visible? What does that do? Yeah, that'll help. Okay, so we're going to click on UV and we're going to do a cylindrical map because, you know, we're working on a cylinder, that makes sense. And we'll click on that. And that actually looks very clean. We don't need to do anything else to that. That just worked. So I'm just going to move that up out of the way for a minute. I'm pretty darn happy with that. Next thing is to do some other bits and bobs. So let's go back into this face mode and I want that ring there. And I'm going to UV map this one with a planar projection on the y-axis. And that's just that bit there. So just move that over there. And I want the one on the bottom as well. And we'll just perform the same sort of projection on that. And move that one up out of the way so I know that they go together. Okay, whilst I'm working on the top and bottom, I'll get this one here done. Beautiful, and that's going to be on the y-axis as well. So I can go there, and then I need to do the bottom. So select all these faces. It's got to be a quicker way of doing this. And then we're going to go to UV planar. Pachoom! There we go, right. Now, you can see that I've got these weird little things going on here. And what they are these bits here. And these need to be cylindrically mapped as well. So I'm going to try and do these at the same time. So let's do UV cylindrical. And that looks okay. And I'm going to try, not quite. I'm just going to scale this up a little bit so that it goes to the top and bottom of that as near as I can get it. Just to try and match those up. Because that will make my life easier in Photoshop. Yep, that looks okay. Right. All I've got to do now is get all this to fit in the 0-1 space so that I can have this ready. So I'm going to click on this and see if it will just give me a favorable layout. Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. Let's see what it gives me. Is that something I can work with? I'm not happy with that. I think I'm going to do it manually. So I might not get the most efficient layout doing this, but I like to be in control. Get off. Object to shell. Okay, so I'll get those three shells and move them in. And I want these to pretty much be the width of my 0-1 space. So I think I need to go full screen for this. I want to be able to see what I'm doing. So let's pull that over. I can go a little bit bigger than that. Brilliant. Okay, and we'll move that down to the bottom. Okay, next I'm going to get these two. And I can see that I'm going to have fun making these all fit. I think what I'm going to try and do to maximize the space is I'll bring these in around those, but try and give myself a little bit of space. Like that, I think that looks okay. And I've got one more of these up here. And let's just try and get that kind of centered on there. Bring that in. Ah, stop that. Yeah. Okay, so I'm pretty happy with that. I think I've given myself enough space. So, as UV maps go, that's pretty tasty. Okay, what I can see though, that I'm not particularly happy about, is that I've got some that are red. And that means that they're not facing the right way. The normals are in the wrong direction. So we need to flip those normals and then we'll have a beautifully clean UV map, hopefully. So select something red, if you have anything red, and just click on this and it will flip it around. And basically just take it from being red to being blue, which is all we need. There we go. Right, that is a damn fine UV map. It would probably be a little bit better if my sizes were a bit more consistent, which is really how you're supposed to work, but I'm lazy. Okay, right, now that UV mapping is done and we're happy with that, in the next step we're going to do the actual baking. So we're going to bake the normal data from the high poly mesh onto the low poly mesh. So I hope you will join me in the next step for that. Okay, here we go. Let's bake some maps. Right. Okay. I have here my low poly mesh. So first thing you need to do is click on that, make sure that's selected. Change from your modeling menu set to your rendering menu set. And then the tool we're looking for is in lighting and shading, and it's called Transfer Maps. So let's give that a little clicky. Wonderful. Right, the first thing I'll do is reset this so that we're looking at the same thing. Right, so because we had this selected when we opened the tool, it's loaded this in under the target mesh. And whenever you're baking normal maps, your low poly mesh will be the target mesh because that's the thing you're looking to keep. So that one goes in there. In the source mesh, I'm just going to hide that one and bring back the high poly mesh and just stop it being referenced a minute so I can click on it. And I'm going to click on add selected. So that is going to be where it sources the information from, and I can just reference that again and bring the low poly back as well. Right, then you need to choose what kind of map you're after, and I want a normal map, and we're going to change some settings. So click on the little folder. I do want it in my source images folder. I'm going to call it sampled normals, and I don't want an alias pix format because that's a stupid format. I'm going to use a targa. If you've watched any of my other videos, you'll know that I feel passionately about the targa format. Click on save, and then, yeah. So then you can choose between object or tangent space normals. If your asset's going to be static, then apparently you can use object space. If it might ever be animated in any way, then you need to use tangent space. Personally, I would say to you, always use tangent space. I can't see a reason that you would use object space. If anybody knows what that reason is, feel free to leave a comment. But I'm all about the tangent space, so I'll leave that as it is. This bit here, connect maps to a shader and connect it to a new shader. What that will do is once we've baked the normals, it will assign it to a Lambert, and that Lambert will be placed on the low poly mesh. So it means we can preview the results straight away. So I'll leave that where it is. Then under Maya Common Output, normally you probably wouldn't want too high of a texture resolution on a barrel, but because it's the only thing that we're interested in, we're going to go fairly high. We'll do a 1024 by 1024 map. And the sampling quality we'll do at medium, which should be good enough for what we're doing. Okay, so that's most of the settings done. The only thing we need to look at is what's going to be captured within this bake. To check that, you've got, for your low poly barrel back up at the top, you've got this little display section. At the moment, it's displaying the mesh, which is the actual low poly mesh. And there's another thing called an envelope, which is this pink thing here. I would say show both, but basically what you need to do, if it might for you start off something low, but you can see when it's at 0%, it's not, everything needs to be encapsulated within this search envelope, because that's what's going to be included in your bake. So you need to make sure that basically you can't see any grey, you can only see pink. So in my case, that appears to happen at 3.8. I'm quite happy with that. So that's now set up. I'm happy with that. So what we can do next is bake it. Oh, hang on, let me just check in here. Is that right? Am I happy with that? Yeah, that's all good. So what we'll do is click on bake and close. And what will happen now is that is sampling and baking the normal data into an image file and assigning that to a shader. So when that's finished, we'll have a look at the result. Okay, so my bake has just finished. And I thought I would wait and we would preview the results together. I feel like we'll bond more if we do it that way. So let's hide the high poly mesh. You can see this is the low poly mesh, which is, there it is. So what we'll do is that material is already applied, but because we aren't showing textures, we can't see it. So you can either click on this icon here, which is textured, or you can press 6 on your keyboard, which is what I'm going to do. And you'll see that that detail that we had on the other mesh is now showing through on this one. And let's see what it's looking like on top. So you can see that there are now lines where the planks that we put were. Okay, I think, so I've got a dirty black line at the bottom, which is probably because it maybe sticks out a little bit too far there, which I could fix. In fact, I will fix it. Let's see if we can fix that. So I'm going to go back into the high poly. And we're going to get, hang on, let's take it out of reference. Okay, edge. We're going to get these edges, I think. That one, and that one. And we're just going to scale them in like that. What's the top looking like? Yeah, the top's okay. So, I've brought that in to hopefully get a cleaner bake. So I'll stick that back into reference. And now what I can do is, I'll just hide that, perform the bake again, but I should get some different results out of it. So let's see. I don't know how different, but hopefully slightly better. So lighting, shading, transfer maps. Everything's set up as before, so we don't need to bother going through everything again. We can just click on bake and close, and it'll replace the normal map we have. So I'll see you in a sec. Fingers crossed, it'll all be brilliant next. Okay, so that bake's finished. It's improved it a bit, but it's not perfect. I think it's generally when you've got quite a high angle on this. By the time it's textured, it won't look as bad. So I'm happy with that. We've now got a normal map that we can work with. Okay, before we take this into Photoshop for texturing, we're going to create one more map for it, which I'm going to call a color ID map, which will make it easier to kind of place textures around a bit faster. So in order to do that, and we'll just do it as quickly as we can, we're going to apply some colored materials, I'll take that out of reference, to everything on this. So what we'll do is we're just going to go to back into modeling, we're going to go mesh and separate, so everything's a separate polygon again. And we're just going to bang some colors on this. So I know that I want the metal to be a separate color. So I'm going to assign a new material to that. It's going to be a Lambert. And I just want it to have a color. Where is that? Lambert 6. So I'm just going to choose quite, you know, bold color. So I'll use red in this case. Okay, and then I'm going to assign existing material to all the ones that are going to have the same material on there. So, assign existing material, Lambert 6. assign existing material Lambert 6. Right, and then what I want to do is be able to break up the different planks. So this first plank I'm going to assign a new material to, which will be a Lambert, and the colour of this one will be yellow. Why has that not worked? Assign new material, Lambert, yellow. Hey, there we go. Right, and then the one next to it, in fact, let's just assign this. So I'm going to do it to every other one. Okay, so I've done that. Now what I want to do is do the alternate ones with another equally kind of contrasting colour. So let's assign a new material, a Lambert, and this time I'm going to use green. And now I'm going to apply that to all the other alternating planks. Okay, and then I just need to repeat that for the planks on the top and the bottom, and I'll be complete. So that will make it really easy to pick out different areas of the map when we're in Photoshop later. So we're going to bake this out to another map. So let's just recombine this. So mesh combine, I want to give this the name high underscore poly underscore barrel again. And because this is now seen as a new object, it won't be part of that high poly layer anymore. So we're going to make sure it's selected, right click and add selected objects. And now I'll be able to hide that and turn it to reference if I need to. So let's just load in transfer maps again. So we're going to go to rendering. We're going to go to lighting, shading, and the transfer maps. I'm going to use a different type of map this time. So we'll get rid of the normal. We're going to use a diffuse map this time, and that'll bake the color from one to the other. So the source mesh needs to be the high poly. So let's just load that in. And then we can turn that off for a little while. And then we're going to choose diffuse. And we're going to call this one color ID. But I don't need that capital O there. That's cray cray. And we're going to do a target again. And click on save. And everything else should be set up fine from what we did before. Which it is. So now we're going to bake that from one to the other. Let's click on bake. Okay, so the bake's just finished, and you can see that it now looks ridiculous. But the cool thing is we've now got a little bit of an idea of where that metal would be. If you look at the mesh without the texture, there's no indication. So even on the UV map, we wouldn't know exactly where to put the metallic parts of the texture. But we can now see that that's where it'll go. So that's really good. So if I can just show you what we've created in Photoshop. So this is the normal map. There you go. So you can see all that detail is on there that we created, which is lovely. And if we have a look at the color ID map as well. And all the color ID map exists for is so that we can sample colors and put stuff there. So we can create like masks using those colors. It's just about being able to select different areas. So we are now done with the modeling. We are done with the texture baking. All that is left to do is to create the actual materials in Photoshop. So we're going to create the different texture maps. So there'll be a diffuse or albedo map. There will be a roughness map. There will be a metallic map. There will be maybe another kind of map that I'm forgetting. But in the next section, that's what we will be covering. It'll be all about texturing. So hopefully I will see you in the next section for that. Okay, here we are in Photoshop. Let's see if we can create some awesome textures. Right, so I'm actually going to start on the color ID map. This is the one I'm going to create as like my, or treat as my base material. So I'm going to file, save as, and I'm going to just call this barrel texture master. And I'm going to try and put all my different texture maps into this one file, and I can just save them out one at a time, but we'll get to that. Okay, so I don't want this as a target, I want this as a Photoshop file, because I need to save everything in this. So let's click on save. Right, so all this is going to be is like a reference layer. We're never actually going to see this. So I am going to duplicate it, just so that it's not a locked background layer. I'm just going to rename this to color ID. Okay, so the first thing I probably want to do is to get the wooden materials on here. So that's what I'll concentrate on first of all. So I'm going to open, what am I going for? Wooden planks. This is going to be the first thing I need. Okay, so let's just select pretty much everything. I don't need that white band on the bottom, so I'll leave that alone. And I'm just going to copy with Control and C, go back into my texture master, and I'm going to press Control and V to paste that in. And that's going to need some serious resizing. So I'm holding Shift. In fact, let's go through the whole process. Control and T to turn on your transform tool. And then every time I click on the corner, I'm holding Shift because I want to keep the dimensions. So I don't want to distort this at all. There we go. So I'm just going to try and keep the height about right. So about there, something like that. Okay, now pretty much all I need to do is put some planks in place. So I might just put this, kind of running out of room. Yeah, we'll put it over here and I'll just move it over a bit at a time, probably. Right, so let's just press enter to save that, control and zero, and then let's get some selection. So the first thing is I'm going to get rid of all of that. So press backspace. And then I'm going to grab that, which is going to be an entire plank, hopefully. And with my move tool, I'm just going to move it over. And I'm aiming to cover the green and on the one above it, the yellow area. So I'm going to hit Control and T to free transform this. And I can overlap slightly, but I'm just covering that with a plank, really. And then what I need to do is repeat that again. So I'm going to grab the next plank. And then with my move tool, I'm going to move this over again. And again, I'm going to go over slightly, I think, because I'm going to use some masking to sort this out like that. So that's working out okay, isn't it? So that's two. I'm going to repeat this with one plank at a time until I've covered all the green areas. Okay, so I've just finished laying my sort of first layer of planks. So now what I want to do is I'm just going to hide that for a second. And I'm going to use my magic wand tool to select all these green areas. Okay, so what I'm going to do is just select a green area for a start. I'm going to go to select similar. Okay, and then I'm going to press Alt on my keyboard and just deselect these yellow chunks up here. and replace them, green chunks, sorry. I'm gonna deselect all the green chunks and I'm gonna replace them with the yellow ones. So I'm now gonna hold shift on my keyboard to add in these yellows. Like that. So that should now all be the pieces that I want to be selected. And then, with that selection in place, I'm gonna go back to this layer. I'll just turn it on. And making sure that selection is still there, I'm gonna click on this here, which creates a mask. And then you can see that that plank has only gone where I want it to. There are a few places though that still need a little bit of work that haven't quite copied through. So in order to get that, I'm just gonna get a white brush and use my paintbrush. So I'm gonna click on the actual layer here. Just bring that up. Bring that brush size down. Make sure it is a hard-edged brush. I'm just gonna paint in the mask in any areas that I'm not happy with. Like that. Just turn that opacity up, that's why that's not working. So I've got a bit of black there showing through that I don't like. So this would probably be all right on the final map, but I don't particularly want to risk it. So I'm just tidying things up where I think I might need to. And I think I also need to add these areas to the mask as well. So I'm just going to do that. And I just don't want to leave any areas with blank. I can overlap a little bit on this because the two maps in a sec, I'm going to kind of cross this with another map and the two maps should work together. So I just need to get this in place. Okay, so I'm pretty happy with that for my first kind of layer of planks. I now need to repeat that on another layer. So I'll speed that up and I'll repeat the process to get two lines of planks, which is what I'm going for. Okay, so what I've done in this instance is I've just created a layer with all the planks going across like that, which should work okay in a sec. So what I'm going to do is just go to my color ID map. I'm going to select all the red. So click on one bit of red, go to select similar. And then I'm going to go back onto this layer here that contains all the planks and just hit backspace, just to bring that red back through. I'll turn on this layer as well. So now you should be able to see that they're working together nicely. I've got a nice bit of variation going on for this barrel. So that's so far so good, I think. What I'm gonna do now, because I'm pretty happy with that, is I'm just gonna merge these two layers, merge layers like that. And that layer's finished now. I'm happy with that. The next thing to do is work on these layers up here. So what I'm going to do for that is create some new masks, I think. Okay, so the next job is to get some textures going on these. So all I'm going to do is get another sample of these wooden planks. I need kind of a square area. So I quite like that. And I'm just gonna copy that over. And we'll have a new layer for this. And that's obviously going to need scaling down. And rotating around. And putting in place. Okay, so what I'll do is I'll knock the opacity down on this one so I can see where I'm putting it. I'm going to try my absolute bestest to line this up without having to do one plank at a time. So you can see I'm lining that edge up with that one there, and I'm just going to bring that in as well as I can. I'm happy with that. So that doesn't need to be too neat because I'm going to overwrite it with these textures on there. So I'm happy with that one. That's nice. And then I'm going to get another sample of wooden planks to put on the other side. So that looks good. And let's just zoom out again. I'm going to paste this one in place and scale it down and rotate it around, knock the opacity down so I can see what I'm doing, zoom in, and again I'm going to try and put this in place so it starts about there, and I'm just going to pull that in like that. What are we looking at here now? So that now needs moving down to line that one up, and I can pull that up. Yeah, that's close enough. So I'll put the opacity back up on those, and I'll zoom out. Press Control and 0 to go full screen. Oh, if it wants to work. There we go. Right, so I'm happy with both of those. They look grand. I'm going to merge those layers. Merge layers. Okay, now what I need to do, I'll hide those for the time being, and now I just need to get some individual pieces of wood that go over these pieces here. And once I've got those, I'll be happy. So I'll show you how to put a few of those in, and then once they're sorted, you can do the rest. So we just need to place those around. So all I'm going to do as well is I'm just going to do it for one and try and transfer it over to the other side, just to save time. Okay, so basically what I'm going to do is, as I, like normally you would resize like that, but if I hold control as I do it, I can skew the actual dimensions of this and it'll kind of just fit in nicely with the shape I'm going for. So, like that. And then what I'm going to do is I'll reuse these wherever I can, so I'm just going to duplicate that layer. And then I'm going to move this to here. So I'm probably going to do the same one every third. So we're going to do a free transform and rotate this around until it fits in place. That looks like a good fit. And then I'll duplicate that again. And I think you kind of get the idea of what's happening now. So I'll go all the way around and get my other samples in, merge all those layers together, and then we'll move on to getting the metal on. So you'll see how this comes together. Okay, so now you should be able to see that I have gone all the way around this particular part of the UV map, and I'm happy with that. But what I need to do is merge all that into one layer. So it starts here, so I'll click on that top one, all the way down to the bottom one, hold shift to select all the layers, right click and merge layers. And then I will just get my move tool to make sure that they all move together. They do. Okay, so I'm happy with that. And then what I'll do is duplicate that layer by dragging it onto there. Let's see if we can move that straight across and get it as close as I possibly can. That's pretty close. And I'm going to hit Control and T. And I'm going to hold Alt and Shift when I resize this so that it scales from the center. I don't want to interfere with the bottom of this too much. So that looks okay. Hopefully. So now I've got a lot of layers that I can now merge. Let's merge all these together. Wait, don't merge them. Whew. It's very important before I merge anything that these layers that I've just created, these circular ones, go on top so that then I don't have to worry about what else can and can't be seen. And then I'll merge all of these. Okay, and I'm just going to call this layer Wood Diffuse. So I am so ecstatically happy with that. That is now that part of the material complete. What I need now is to create the metallic part. So I need to go back into my color ID map. I'm going to hide the wood for now. And I'm going to open the metal. There it is. Right, what I'm going to do is select almost all of it. I'm just not going to bother with the bottom again. Now, I'm not convinced that this is a seamless texture, so this might create a seam. If you want to create a seamless texture, there are ways of doing that. There are many tutorials. For time reasons, I'm not going to worry too much about that. If I get a visible seam, it can be something that I would just correct later. But you would make this probably a seamless material first. Anyways, I'm going to go to Control and C to copy that, and I'm going to bring it in here, and I'm going to press Control and V to bring in this metallic layer, and I'm going to press Control and T on here and scale this down so that it kind of fits where I want it to fit, which is just over the areas where there is some red. So it's going to start about there. I don't mind there being a little bit of distortion on this. About there. Right, so that's now on the layer. I'm going to go to my color ID map. I'll just hide that for a second. Select anything that's red. Select similar. So I've got a selection of just red. Go back to my metal layer and put a mask on there. And you can see that that now shows where the metal should be. So that's good. I'm going to call this layer Metal Diffuse. Right, at that stage, we've done it. We have a diffuse texture. Now, I'm not quite happy with, if we zoom in, there's, I think, a little bit of yellow and green showing through. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to delete this mask. Delete it. I'm going to go back to my color ID, click on red again, select similar, and I'm going to go under select and I'm going to modify, and I'm going to expand this by 1 pixel just to make that selection a little bit bigger so that I'm not going to see any of my color map underneath that. And then I'll go back onto my metal diffuse and I'll put the mask on. Yep, and that looks much cleaner. Right, so that is my diffuse texture. So I'm going to save this out at this point. So File, Save As, Targa, and I'm going to call this Barrel diffuse, and you can see it's going to my source images folder, which is good. Save. Right, here's a question for you. If it asks you, do you want 24 or 32 bits per pixel? Unless something's going to be see-through, it's always 24. 32 bits per pixel gives you a transparency alpha layer, so we don't want that. Okay, so that's that first material done. What we need to do now is create a roughness map. So what I'll do is I'm going to select both of these, right click, and I'm going to, in fact not right click, I'm going to go down here and create a new folder for them, which is a group, and I'm just going to call that diffuse. Wicked. Okay, what I want to do now is copy both of these layers. I'm going to take them out of my diffuse. Just move them below there, that's it, right. So take them out of my diffuse group. I can close that. And this is now going to become my wood roughness. And you are going to become my metal roughness. Like that. Right, and now I'm going to modify these so that I get something that's quite rough. So on my wood layer, I'm going to go to Image, Adjustments. I'm going to desaturate it to make sure it's black and white. You won't notice a massive difference on that because it already looked pretty black and white. And I'm going to go to Image, Adjustments, and I'm going to do Levels, I think. And what I want is something that is quite white, because this is quite a rough barrel I'm going for. So okay, I can't see anything happening because I need to hide my diffuse layer. Let's try this again. Silly Shane. Okay, Image, Adjustments, Levels. Okay, so I'm going to take out a lot of the black. Almost all of the black, to be fair. Yeah, I'm going to go for that. So that's going to be my roughness there. Okay, for my metal, I don't want that to be particularly rough at all. So I'm going to desaturate this one as well. Take out the colour. And I want this to be a little bit rough because I'm going for like an aged metal. But not too rough. So I think I'm going to try leaving that where it is. I could always come back and change it if I want to. So that's okay. So I think at this stage I'm going to save out my roughness map. File, save as. Okay, so I'm going to save it as a targa. This one's going to be called barrel roughness. Oh, roughiness? No. Barrel roughness, good. And I don't want alpha channels, so get rid of that. Save. Right, so I'm now going to put these in their own layer. I'm going to put them in their own folder. So this is going to be roughness. R-O-U-G-H-N-E-S-S. Okay. Right. I'm going to copy these again. And get the two copies and just get them out of those groups. Right, this time I need a metallic map. And that's very, very easy because, first of all, things are either metallic or they're not. So for the wood diffuse, I actually don't need that to be part of this. So I'm going to delete that layer. And I only need metal. So let's just hide the diffuse layer again and hide the color ID. Maybe I do want the wooden layer. Let me just bring that back. But what I'm going to do with this wooden layer is just fill it with black. So I'm just going to press Control and Delete to do that. And that does that. So I'm going to call this Wood Metallic. Like so. And then my Metal Metallic. Metallic. I'm going to pull that in front of the wood so that I can see it. And this wants to be pretty much white. So I'm going to desaturate this layer. Image adjustments desaturate. Like so. And then I'm going to mess with the levels adjustments. Levels. I'm just going to take out almost all of the black, like that. And that is my metallic map. So file, save as. Okay, this is going to be a targa as well. Don't want alpha channels, and this one's going to be called barrel metallic. Like so, I'm happy with that. And then there's one more thing that we need to do, and that's get sexy ass normal map. So let's put these two into a group and call this one metallic. And then I'll be hiding that. Right, now what I need is my sampled normals. So Control A, Control C. I'm going to copy this in just above the layer with my color ID map. So we'll paste that there. So that is the first part of a normal map, but we can actually do a little bit better than that. And the way I'm going to do that is I'm going to copy the wood and the metal diffuse layers again. So let's get a copy of that. And then I'm going to, if it will let me, just drop those on the layer just in front of the normal map. I'm then going to merge them. So merge layers. And I'm then going to desaturate them. Image adjustments and desaturate. Okay, so you can see that that's now laid on top. Now, Photoshop, if you've got the right version, has got a very wonderful filter in there. If you click on it, go to 3D, you can generate a normal map. And I'm going to generate a normal map off of this wood and metal. So let's give it a second. It'll give us, if you can see there, the kind of fine detail, which will make the normal map look a lot... It'll just make it look better, do you know what I mean? That's what we want. It's going to make it look a lot better. So you can mess with all these settings. I'm just going to go with the default because it should give me what I need. So I'll click on OK. Like so. And I now have a normal map that sits on top of this. And what I want to do with that normal map is blend it. Now, there is a better way of doing what I'm about to do. I'm just going to do it the quickest way. So with the wood diffuse copy layer on top, I'm going to go to here, which is your blending style, and I'm going to go to overlay. And you'll see that blends them together. So now I'm getting both sets of normal information, and that'll be wicked. So I'm going to save this out as a normal map file. Save as, and I'm going to call this one, once it's a targa file, targa barrel normal. Save. Okay. Right. I'll just do a little bit of tidying up here before we move on. So let's get both those layers. So we've got, we'll call this detail normal. Or we would if I could spell. Detail normal. And this one here is going to be sampled normals. Oh, come on, Shane. What are you doing? Like that. And we'll put these in a folder. Oh, try again. Folder. And we'll call this normal. Okay, now we're just going to save this Photoshop file. So, we've saved all the different maps onto different layers and into different folders so we can come back and make any changes that we need to. But what we'll do now is we'll tie up the texturing part. Because it's taken ages, hasn't it? Jesus. Okay, so what we'll be doing in the next and final step is we'll be back in Maya and we're going to build a material that will show all this beautiful detail off. So we'll be using a physically based rendering shader, which looks miles better than your standard sort of Lamberts or Fongs or Blins. So I will see you in the next step for that, and then we'll be finished. Yes. Okay, dudes, here we are back in Maya. Let's get stuck in with texturing. So you can see at the moment, our low poly barrel still looks ridiculous. So let's get into the hyper shade. And basically, I've got a buttload of textures that I don't need, so I'm just going to delete them all. Well, if it will let me. Oh, if they're assigned, you can't delete them. That's new. Well, maybe you can. Okay, so my barrel should now be green because it's angry. It's got no material. Good. Let's create a new material. So I want to create a stingray PBS. So I've got a feeling if I type in stingray, it's not there. Right. And this can happen. And if it does, you just need to go into Windows, Settings Preferences, and Plugin Manager. And you're looking for Shader FX plugin. There it is. Make sure it's loaded and make sure it's on auto load. Then when you open your Hypershade, you'll be able to see that you've got a Stingray PBS that you can create. So let's create a new Stingray PBS. Okay, here it is. This is the shader node. Now we need to make sure we can see this because we're going to need to keep clicking on it. Okay, and we know what different maps we created. So we know that we had a color map, a normal map, a metallic, and a roughness map. So we're going to use all four of those on this barrel. And then if you scroll down a bit further, you can choose your texture maps. So the color map, I'll click on that, and then I'll assign the file, which is going to be barrel diffuse. There it is. Click on open. And then you see I now can't find where to assign my other textures. So what I need to do is click back on this Stingray PBS one node over here, and then I can go and add my normal map. And then we'll find that one, barrel normal, open. And then back on this purple node here, I'm going to add my metallic map. So where's that one? Barrel metallic, open. And then click on this one more time to add the roughness map, if I can find it. Roughness, and click on open. Right, that's it, you've built the material. So then all you need to do is assign that material to your barrel. So I did that just by middle mouse clicking and dragging to put that on. Okay, so let's now zoom in on this, and you should see, so straight away, my metal band is looking a little bit too rough, so I might go back in and just even that out in the material if I was going to spend more time on this. But the actual barrel itself is looking pretty nice. Now, a good way to get your normal detail to show through is to create a light. So let's go to create lights, and we'll do a directional light, I think. We'll just move this out so we can see it. And we'll press 7. So that we can see that happening. And what we'll do is we'll just rotate this around, and you should be able to see, especially here, the graininess of the wood, which looks kind of nice. Whew, that's pretty, isn't it? So all that extra detail is coming through because we baked from the high detail and we've spent a lot of time in Photoshop making that look really cool. One final thing before we wrap this up that it's worthwhile taking a look at is if we click back on this Stingray shader node and scroll up, you can actually turn these off and you can see what each map's doing. So you can see, just with a normal map on, how much detail's coming through from that normal map. So that's really nice. You can see, if you want, just what the metallic map's doing. So you can see it's telling which areas are going to be metallic. If you pair that with your roughness map, then you actually get a lot more detail. But again, you can see that these really hard edges are there. So if we bring in the normal map, they'll then make sense because they add some depth, and if we add the color map, it'll look like a barrel. Okay, so that about wraps this tutorial up. I hope you found it useful. I hope it will help you work on your high poly to low poly workflow. It's also a good way of working on a PBR texture map workflow as well for things like Unity and Unreal, especially Unreal. I've used the Unreal texture maps for this one, the metallic roughness method. If you want to download this exact barrel that I'm using here, then if you choose to become a patron using Patreon, then you'll have access to my shared folders, and you'll be able to download this barrel, the texture files that I made, and you can have a play around with them yourself, as well as asking me any questions. If you got stuck on anything or get stuck on anything, put a comment below the video. I'll help you out if I can. I want to say a big thank you to my current patrons that are helping me to create these videos, that are supporting me. In case you're wondering, my patrons have paid for this, which is a brand new microphone, and I've got a mic arm as well, so that this will really make it easier for me to just sit down and record you chores. You won't even believe what a faff it was before I got hold of this. I'd also like to thank the sponsor of this video, environmenttextures.com. Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to have a sponsor. That just makes me feel like I'm special. And for letting me download the textures to be able to create this tutorial. I really do recommend that you check out environmenttextures.com. There's some really, really good stuff on there. There's some models on there. There's some scans, 3D scans of real life geometry as well, which is really cool. There is a link below the video for you to check that out, so please do go and take a look. I think you'll think it's a really good site. I do, you know, I'm all into using it, so you should check it out. And so, as always, thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.